But in Ulster, the reaction was uncompromising. It would not be brooked. The Orange Order marched in protest. 50,000 Ulster men heard their leader, Sir Edward Carson, tell them,
"We must be prepared, the morning home rule passes, ourselves to become responsible for the government of the Protestant province of Ulster."
They had staunch allies in the British Conservative Party. Andrew Bonar Law, Conservative Party leader, assured Belfast crowds that
the Conservative Party will do all that men can do to defeat a conspiracy as treacherous as had ever been formed against the life of a great nation.
100,000 men had marched to Balmoral, outside Belfast, to hear the leader of the Conservative Party, the party of law and order, advocate the use of violence. For Bonar Law, home rule was an exceptional issue, demanding an exceptional response.
Bonar Law, the Conservative leader, has the view, really, that what the government is trying to do is to pass an unconstitutional act, an act which will actually destroy the state itself. But therefore, the government has no right to pass this act. It's not that the opposition hasn't got the right to oppose it by whatever means. The opposition, in fact, is doing its constitutional duty in virtually threatening civil war if this act is carried through. So this is an enormously intense opposition, and Bonar Law even goes to the extent of referring to the government as a revolutionary committee which has seized upon despotic power by fraud. Almost unbelievable language in the 20th century, language which really hasn't been heard since the English Civil War.
At a great demonstration at Blenheim Palace near Oxford in July, Bonar Law went further.
"There are things stronger than parliamentary majorities. If an attempt were made to deprive these men of their birthright, they would be justified in resisting, by all means in their power, including force."
A sensitive nerve had been touched in the Conservative mind.
The whole image of Britain, its role in history almost, as the dynamic, expanding industrial power, the epicenter of Europeanism, all this is tied up in the concept of the empire, so that the whole British self-image is really at stake when people are thinking about the Union, and that's what the Irish are threatening. They're sticking a knife into this whole assumption that the British way is right. The Irish are saying the British way is wrong for us, and maybe a lot of other people would turn round if the Irish succeeded in this and say the British way is wrong for us as well. And this is a sort of heresy.
This was the Indian summer of the British Empire. Empire was the British achievement, the fulfillment of a duty to civilize the world. How could anyone, Indian, African, or Irishman, not wish to be associated with such high ideals, such splendid achievements? Home rule implied that for some, there might be a better way than the British way. To question that was to question the quality of British civilization itself. Such was the Conservative mind. Belfast, September 1912. More prosaic reasons to resist home rule. With Carson, thousands of loyalists marched to sign a covenant affirming their loyalty to king and country.
We were very much concerned with being members of the United Kingdom, and I can assure you, I signed it from a sense of duty. We wanted to stay as we had been under Britain with the Imperial Parliament.
our leaders at the beginning signed their name in blood. They cut themselves and signed it that way. And a good many of the men wanted to do the same, but that would have taken too long.
Carson was the first to sign.
We didn't want to force anything on anybody else, but they didn't want them to force us to accept home rule. We wanted to be left in peace.
It was necessary to show the English government that they wanted it maintained and they didn't want any truck with passing it over to an Irish parliament in Dublin.
Their signatures pledged them to use any means necessary to defeat home rule.
And this, of course, implied a wide variety of possibilities outside simply debating home rule in Parliament or allowing Parliament to decide. And, of course, as a result of the Covenant, the Ulster Volunteer Force was set up in 1913 and organised and grew to an extent of about 90,000 men between the ages of 16 and 65.
This vigilante army, the Ulster Volunteer Force, seen here at the house of James Craig, Carson's lieutenant, introduced a whole new dimension to the Home Rule debate. It was clear that the Unionists had not only the will to fight, but were building the organisation to make the fight effective. For the moment, they drilled without weapons. In the south, there were demonstrations like this one in County Carlow in support of Home Rule. But few Irish nationalists understood the significance of events in the north. It was only a bluff, they assured themselves.
They didn't take it seriously, and they concentrated their efforts on convincing the British not to take it seriously either, and convincing them to effectively stand by their Home Rule commitment and to call the Ulster Bluff effectively.
But the British government knew that it was serious. Asquith came up with a compromise. Ulster was offered the right to opt out of Home Rule for 6 years. It did not placate the Ulster Unionists. They were determined to stay in the United Kingdom forever. Carson was dismissive.
A sentence of death with a stay of execution for 6 years.
The marshalling of the Ulster Loyalists continued. In London, the cabinet considered reports of an arms build-up in the province. As a precaution, it was decided to augment the British military presence in the north. The Navy was ordered to Ireland. But when British officers garrisoned near Dublin got wind of orders to move them up to the north, they made it clear that they would resign rather than move against the Unionists. The plan was quietly dropped.
Although one may doubt whether the bulk of the army would, in fact, have disobeyed any legitimate commands which were given to them, this is clearly something which gives the Liberals further pause for thought. It means that Asquith is faced with this terrific opposition. One of the weapons by which he might enforce obedience seems to be shaky. And on top of it all, finally, the Ulster Volunteers, the armed organisation of the Ulster Protestants, they run in a really formidable number of guns, which transforms them really overnight into a major military force.
On the night of the 24th of April 1914, nearly 25,000 German guns had been run into Ulster. Now the Ulster Volunteer Force drilled with rifles and were to be seen guarding Carson amid Belfast crowds. Carson and his deputy Craig now commanded a formidable army.
They were absolutely determined to resist Home Rule and defend the Union in this way, by force of arms. Craig said to Carson that all his plans were ready and that he waited only for a signal from Carson to put them into operation.